We're going to show you today how you might go about trying to film the Northern Lights. Oh my God.
Oh my goodness, oh my goodness, oh my goodness.
Oh gosh, it's like dancing around.
It's amazing.
This is where it's supposed to go. Yeah, we're totally in
contact. Super bright, I can see it on the video, Jonas.
No, I don't,
Oh my God.
Check this, how would I see it? This is ridiculous, man.
Yeah, baby!
Oh, mother flippin'.
It's pitch black out. All you can really see are the stars. And right now it is a very, very starry night. Eventually, bam, up come green lights. In this episode of 52 Things, we're gonna walk you through how you might photograph the Northern Lights. And I understand the cost and time involved on this technique may be outside of most people's reach, but if you get lucky enough, the lights may actually pass over your head. Look how far south they've been before, so I think it's worth being prepared. So we're gonna walk through roughly a dozen tips, some that many tutorials don't really tell you about photographing the lights, but that we thought were worth mentioning. And understand that much of this lesson today is about shooting at night, with some special emphasis about these magical lights. So before we get into any of the shooting details, I think it's worth understanding what we're shooting. These are the Northern Lights as seen from the International Space Station. It's spectacular. They're essentially the interaction of Earth's magnetic field in the atmosphere with solar storms originating from the sun. And these geomagnetic solar events take some 18 hours from the sun to reach the Earth. So they're somewhat hard to predict too far in the future, but they do happen pretty regularly. What we do know is that the Earth's magnetic field deflects these solar storms, and the energy is channeled towards small bands around Earth's Arctic regions, some in the northern hemisphere and some in the southern. Places along this so-called aurora belt are the best place to see the lights. The belt can shift a little bit up, a little bit down, but starting here is a good point. Now, if you go too far north, or you go too far south, then your chances decrease significantly. And that's why we're heading right here to the northernmost airport in Sweden.
Just landed. It is cold up here.
I've never been this far north. We are heading into the Arctic Circle.
This is Kiruna, a town that in mid-January only gets 3 hours of daylight. And in that time, we still never really saw the sun. Instead, it provided a steady glow on the mountains, essentially golden hour all day long. It was awesome. Our end destination was about an hour and a half from the airport at a place called Abisko.
Apparently, this is one of the best places in the world to see the Northern Lights, but that, of course, is dependent on the fact that the clouds are not there.
Before we got there, we visited the Ice Hotel, which was awesome. I'll save that for another video. We got to see some reindeer, which was awesome. And I flew the drone in an Arctic storm, something that I wouldn't really recommend for new drone flyers, but it did give me some of the most epic footage I've ever gotten. It was so cool. In fact, I'm not sure I've ever been more excited to get a shot in my entire life. And finally, we set up camp at the station. The first step in photographing the lights, choosing our location, was done. Now, all we had to do was wait on the weather. The first night wasn't so great. Total whiteout. Second night was cloudy. And while we did actually see some green through the clouds,
this one cloud just started glowing. And I was like, that's not right. That's gotta be something. That's gotta be the aurora or something.
It was underwhelming. The third night was clear and was our best chance. But even a clear night doesn't guarantee you see the lights. And that's where the Aurora app comes in handy.
According to my app right now, it's not the greatest at the moment, but this could change anytime. The weather forecast, freaking cold and windy. Problem is, this is our last night, also my birthday. Can we go?
Yeah.
I have like 5 layers on, man.
Off to our setup. Most of the real tips here are things that you can all practice on any night. For me, I was after a time lapse, which is really just shooting a series of different shots of the Northern Lights. Here are the things we thought about. Getting a solid tripod for the camera. Making sure our camera was shooting in RAW and in manual mode. That meant locking the white balance. I choose daytime temperature. setting a large f-stop to get as much light as possible, setting a long shutter speed, but for us, not longer than say 30 seconds to limit the blur of the stars, and upping the ISO just enough to capture proper exposure. And you may have to play with this number though. Don't go too high, it adds grain. High enough though to get something good on the camera. Then make sure you've locked your focus. This can be pretty tricky when it's pitch black. Here's how we do it.
So we're gonna set the focus on this building here now. We're gonna lock it and we're gonna keep it in manual, and that's what we're gonna start out with when we get down to where we're gonna shoot the northern lights.
Once we've done that, we hook up a remote trigger to our cameras so we don't have to touch it, and then we start firing away. Then I experimented with some panning time lapses.
Gonna move in a clockwise direction.
But to be honest, I think a standard lockdown shot might be my preference. Then don't forget about composition.
Get the camera set up in a spot that has good composition so that if the northern lights come out, then not only do we get to see them, but it's mixed into a photo that looks good.
It can be hard when it's literally pitch black, but fortunately we had scouted a few places in the day and found this overlook of the canyon to be quite nice. Finally, and this is something nobody tells you, take your UV filter off of the camera. On long exposures of the aurora, you can actually get some concentric bands in the middle of your frame. Mike didn't do that and ended up having this in almost every shot. Now that we've done that, we just had to wait. That's when this scene just appeared before us.
Is it going off right now?
I think so, I can't tell, but back there before your light hit me, your white light hit me, I could see it.
Let's go. Over and out, let's go and check this out.
Okay.
It was mind-blowing.
Oh, here we go. Here we go.
Oh gosh, you can see it.
Jonas got the A7S out, which is good at shooting in low light. And this is how bright the aurora is. In the end, I think what we learned from this trip was this. Seeing the aurora is all about understanding how to take night photos. Then, you just have to be lucky enough to get them passing through your shot. And that means you can go out and practice your aurora photography skills now, anywhere you are in the world. In fact, I think you're better off doing it close to home first, than trying to master those camera settings while you're in the field, your hands are frozen, and the rare aurora is passing over your head. In our situation, it only peaked for maybe 15 minutes before it faded away again. Now I'm going to use a future video to show how I worked up one of these images in Photoshop, but I did want to thank everybody for watching, and a big thanks to our supporters on Patreon for their extra support.
Honestly, if you don't have this stuff on your bucket list already, you definitely have to write it down. Extraordinary. So come up here, Northern Sweden is definitely a great place to do it. So, take care guys. I'm just too excited to wrap this up. See you soon.
We'll see you next Tuesday with more tips and tricks to take your photos and videos to the next level.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jonas.
What are you doing over there?
I'm trying to write a thank you to all of you guys for everything that you've done for me already. Somehow, I can't even describe this. So it's taking me forever because I can't put words to it.